we start with the curriculum development process. So as yesterday we have discussed that there are four stages of curriculum. One is need analysis stage, second is your curriculum design stage, third is your curriculum implementation stage, and fourth is your curriculum evaluation. So now in this session, we will be emphasizing on what is the curriculum design process, how a curriculum is prepared, what are different aspects of curriculum design. So these were the four stages. These are the four stages of curriculum development, right? We have just discussed about the need analysis. When we establish need for any program, means there is a employment opportunities for that particular program, then and only then we start the program. Now, once we have identified the various activities, various knowledge and skill attitudes to be developed in the students, then your curriculum design process starts. So in curriculum design, first of all, we state the constraints, because there may be some constraints from university side, from your directorate side, from your, some institution may be deemed university, that constraint may be there. So constraint means which we cannot change. We will discuss it in detail. Then what is activity analysis? Then we will be identifying that what are the various activities a pass out will be performing in the industry. From that we do activity analysis. There are so many activities which a graduate engineer performs in the industry. So we have to identify those activities and analyze in terms of your KSA, knowledge, skill, and attitude. That we will discuss in detail. Then what are your curriculum objectives? Means what are your program educational objectives, your program objectives, and your course program educational objectives, program outcomes, and course outcomes, POCs. Yesterday Professor Pavla has discussed it in detail, and in the subsequent sessions also it will be discussed in the details. Then from curriculum objectives we identify the curriculum areas. Curriculum areas means if we are to achieve these objectives, then what type of subject should be offered. Curriculum area means subject areas. Then detailed contents. To achieve certain course objectives, we are to identify the detailed contents. We will be discussing all these aspects in detail. For identifying detailed contents, we adopt two approaches. One is DECM approach and second is your Delphi technique. Then time requirement. Because we have limited time in the semester, so as per the, there may be so many contents to be taught to the students to achieve your course objectives and ultimately program objective outcomes. So we will have to have time constraints, that this is the time available with us. Means like you have 3 lecture time, 2 periods for your practicals, LTP, lecture, then tutorial and practicals, LTP. That we will discuss in detail. Then horizontal and vertical organization means how you will be arranging your subjects logically so that the students read your prerequisite first and then higher subjects later on. Then we prepare study and evaluation scheme. Right, you have study scheme that these will be the subjects in the semester, this will be their LTP, your lecture class, your then tutorials and practicals, and then your evaluation scheme also. That should also be decided that what will be the marks for the internal assessment, for the external assessment, then your home assignments, your internal assessment test, like that, we give this in study and evaluation scheme. Then selection of appropriate methods and media. Means what will be your strategy for instructions, how you will be teaching. Then resources required. What are the resources for implementing the program? Your physical resources, your human resources, your informational resources, financial resources. So that should also be decided. So first we come to stating constraints. Stating constraint means duration of the program. These are specified by the university or your board. Whether you will be having 4-year degree program or 5-year program, or in diploma 3-year program, 2-year program, that is decided by your respective universities or boards or as per AICTE. Because some minimum time has been specified by the All India Council of Technical Education, AICT. That we will have to also take into consideration. So that we cannot change. Because many times when we design diploma program, they say that the entry qualification for this program may be 10 plus 2. Or for degree program, like in some institutions, they say that for degree in computer engineering, the best qualification should be BSc, because they have more background of mathematics, physics. So like that, people say that there should be some changes in the entry qualification, but that we cannot change. Then program pattern. Program pattern means you have regular program, you may have also part-time program. Because some institution also run programs on part-time basis in the evening. Some diploma programs, some degree program, they come in the evening shift. That is your part-time. Accordingly, you will have to decide the program.
Isn't that the courses that are part-time only, or can they be regular also?
Although it is regular, but that is in the evening, means they are also working somewhere.
That's the issue. If on the final certificate, it will be
written as regular program or part-time? No, nothing. It is not specified. Like here in our CCET diploma wing, they are running diploma in mechanical, electrical, civil in the evening also, but that is of 8 semesters, Dhalsab, 8 semesters or 6 semesters, jo aapka yahan pe polytechnic mein evening program chalta hai, part-time diploma program, 8 semesters, like that, but it is not written on the diploma, whether it is part-time, it is regular.
How we come up with the thinking, if it is a regular program, then it should be for 3 years and 6 semesters, or if it is a part-time program, then it should be for 4 years and 8 semesters?
Because your contents will be decided accordingly. If they have 8 semester program, then all the contents will be distributed to the 8 semesters.
आपको क्लासेस कम मिलती है ना, रेगुलर बढ़ेंगे तब कंटिन्यू 3 महीने क्लास
करेंगे.
Actually,
and I say it will run for only 3 years as a normal regular diploma.
But 3 years you will not be able to cover the contents.
But from 4 to 9 I will be able to do
that. No, like we have this modular program. Here only they come in the winter and in the summer, and they study only 2 subjects. Regular program is of M.Tech is 2 years, but here they have 7 spells in modular program. So like that there is, but you will have to decide the contents accordingly, that you have to teach all the subjects, all the contents in 3 years, 2 years or 7 semesters. That you have to decide now. Accordingly your contents will be distributed.
University has the liberty to design its curriculum and program also according to its need and whatever it requires.
But there are some AICT regulations are also there. You will have to follow that UGC AICT regulations also. It is not that university can do anything, but there are some regulations. You will have to take approval from UGC or AICT. Although you are autonomous university, but you will have to follow UGC guidelines or AICT guidelines. It does not mean that if you are university, you can design anything or float anything or do anything.
They will have to take approval
from first start.
How the approval they cannot take the decision on the show.
Oh.
My question is here, how we approve, we should get that approval. Can there, is there a criteria in which we can negate with them, okay, this program can happen in the evening or not? It's like that. For instance, if I have an university, I want to run a program in the morning or in the evening also. Same diploma program in both the shifts. Can it happen?
Yes. With the approval. With the approval of the authorities, competent authority.
How they judge? They have a criteria?
They have criteria, they have committees, they have expert committees which will decide whether this is viable or not proposal. Then entrance qualification. Then teaching and evaluation system. Annual semester, annual pattern, semester pattern or trimester pattern. Because sometimes some programs are offered on the basis of annual program. Like now Haryana is, I think, converting some programs on the annual pattern. Earlier they were on semester pattern.
First year.
First year, only first year. Right. So syllabus kuch. And then even some programs earlier, there is one slight longwall, they were having some trimester also, which is very rare, but mostly annual and semester system. Then your constraints of resources, culture and location. Very important, because whether you will be having required resources or not, because when we design any program, there are some institutions which say that you don't have much labs in the program. Because if labs are there, you will have to establish the labs. And there is a lot of expenditure, there is a lot of investment on the labs. So we will have to design the program at whatever per year, that resources should be available for this program. Then culture, there are some programs which if we start in some sensitive areas, then they oppose the that program also, because we face this problem in some states that we were starting a particular program, but there the people posed that this program should not be started at this particular institution or particular that area, so the government has to drop that proposal. And what is the location means whether you have some industrial belt is there with which you can interact, or particularly some practicals can happen in that particular industry. You can conduct some practicals in that industry. So your resources, culture and location is also very important while designing your program. Then we come to the activities. Whenever we design any program, then we see that that particular graduate or diploma holder, what are the various activities he or she will be performing in the industry. From those activities, we analyze that what type of knowledge is required for performing that activity, what type of skills are required for performing that activity, and then attitudes. Suppose there is a one activity supervise production activities industry. Our graduates, they perform this activity, they supervise the production activities. Then what type of knowledge is required for performing this activity? He should have knowledge of manufacturing processes. He should have knowledge of tools and tooling. He should have knowledge of scheduling men, material and machines, MMM. He should have knowledge of your codes and standards, because in every branch there are some standards, VAS standards or some other standards related to your branch. Like architecture, they have their own standards. Civil engineering, they have their own standards. Mechanical engineering, they have their own standards. Electronics branch, they have their own standards. So they should have knowledge of codes and standards. Then must be aware of what quality control, about the quality control. So he requires all knowledge of all these subjects, means manufacturing process ki knowledge ho, tools and tooling, scheduling men and material, codes and standards, quality control. So we will be offering the contents related to these knowledge in our program. Then what type of skills they require? They should have skills in planning. They should have skills in organizing the activities, because he is to supervise the production activities. He should have interpersonal skills, means he is to work with the workers, with his seniors, with his juniors. So we should also develop skills in interpersonal skills. Although there may not be any subject on this interpersonal skills, but we will have to give them such learning experiences where these skills are developed in the students. There may be different project work, through project work or through different student-centered activities. Then he should have skills of reading drawings, because he will have to handle the drawings on the shop floor. Then he should be able to lead at the shop floor. Then some attitudes waste minimization. You should be careful that there is minimum wastage. Good housekeeping, that the area is clean, neat and clean. Precision, whatever activities are being performed, that should be very precise, because once any activities go wrong, then your product will be rejected. Leadership qualities. So in our program, we will have to offer all these contents related to your knowledge. If he is to perform this activity, he will have to this type of knowledge, means contents. Contents means through some subject areas, we will be giving these contents details. Right? Then these are your skills and these are your attitudes, which should be developed in the students through different learning experiences. Because in majority of institutions, we are just giving lectures, nothing else. That is why our students are not able to perform in the field, in the industry. They say that your students have some theoretical knowledge only. And moreover, we do not give exposure to the students to the industry where they will be getting the jobs. So we should send the students to the industry also, so that they feel that what is the environment of where he or she will have to work later on, or what type of activities they are performing. Right? Then curriculum objectives. Here your curriculum objectives will depend upon the level of a particular program, whether the program is at certificate level, diploma level, degree level, and the type of competencies which are to be developed in the students. Here your POs, your program outcomes, your course outcomes. Curriculum objective, your program outcomes. Ultimately, what type of outcomes you want to achieve? Program outcomes. What is outcome based education? That what we what is expected from the students to do in the field, and then we assess whether they have achieved what was expected from them to do. So we will have these curriculum objectives depending upon the program, whether it is certificate program, diploma program, or degree program. For example, this is the curriculum objective, that students should be imparted fundamental concepts of, because I am basically civil engineer, so I will be taking some examples from civil only. Should be imparted fundamental concepts of building planning, building bylaws, and be able to apply them for planning and designing of a building. Suppose this is our objective. We want that our students should be able to do this. Then one more, students should have conceptual skills of reading and interpreting engineering drawings. Very important subject. Suppose these are our curriculum objectives, that our students should be able to plan and design a building, or should be able to read and interpret engineering drawings. Then what will be the curriculum areas? Curriculum areas will be your building planning and bylaws, means your subject through which this competency, this objectives will be achieved. And second subject is your engineering drawing. Are you with me? Are you understanding? That is what we do mostly. Because if we want to develop a competency or skill in reading and interpreting drawing, then we teach them engineering drawing, general engineering drawing, then your building drawing, your water supply drawing, your steel drawing, your RCC drawing, like that. So we offer different subjects to the students so that those competencies or your those program outcomes are achieved, right? Then how we decide the detailed contents? One of my friend was asking that how we decide the detailed contents. Determining curriculum contents are directly linked with the competency profile of technical manpower and entry qualification of students to a particular program. Your competency profile of technical manpower. What type of program outcomes you want to achieve? Your competency profile is your what type of program outcomes you want to achieve through a particular program. Then from program outcomes, we decide the subjects, and for every subject, there are some course outcomes. So through detailed contents, we achieve those course outcomes which ultimately cater to your program outcomes. And then program educational objectives, POs, right? Selection of content should be based on the need analysis, which takes into account technological developments, present and future. Based on the need analysis, which was the first stage in curriculum development. So there we have to see whether what are the present needs of the employer and future needs of the industry. So accordingly, we select the contents. For selecting contents, we have two approaches. One is your DECAM approach, and second is your Delphi approach. What is DECAM approach? DECAM approach is developing a curriculum. It relies on experts employed in a specific occupational area to determine curriculum content by following a systematic process. In DECAM approach, what we do? We invite the experts from different fields, from the industry, from the academia, and from industry even, there are different functional areas. Like there may be one design and drawing section, there may be one R&D section, there may be some shop floor management, there may be some quality control, your sales and management, marketing. So we invite different experts from different industry, from different functional areas, and from the academia. Then we sit together and decide that what is the ultimately our program outcomes. From program outcomes, we come to the subject areas, and in the subject areas, we decide the curriculum contents. At NITTR Chandigarh, we adopt this method only. We have seen that in majority of institution, for deciding detailed contents, the teacher goes to the library and there it is decided. No workshop, no feedback from the industry, from other academia. So whenever we want to decide contents of any program, we should invite the relevant experts, and then by consensus, by seeing the requirements of the program, we should decide the contents. I think it's okay now. Then, in this approach, suitable experts representing different sectors of employment. Yesterday, we have talked about three sectors of employment: primary sector, secondary sector, and tertiary sector. And functional areas, different functional areas which we have talked, are identified and asked to participate in a workshop to select the contents for a particular program based on the program outcomes of a curriculum. Because ultimately, our contents should contribute to our PEOs and POs. Your program outcomes, your program educational objectives. So in this way, we decide the detailed contents, not just cut and paste. We have 3, 4, sometimes 6, 7 workshops for deciding the contents of a subject. Then there is one other technique, that is your Delphi technique. This is a little bit cumbersome, because in Delphi technique, we send the questionnaire to the different experts, and then they send us their feedback through mail or through questionnaires, and it takes a lot of time. Here, the experts are not knowing each other, so everybody have their own opinion. So this is a little bit complex. So mainly we follow the DECM approach. The focus is on some curricular content areas in which each individual is knowledgeable. Although it may be beneficial, because we will be taking feedback from a very knowledgeable person, but it takes a lot of time for getting the feedback from the different experts. Information is sought again and again till the consensus on the content is reached. So it is repeated process. Then I have already told that this is a little bit long process and cumbersome process. Then time requirements. Because we have limited time period as per AICT requirements, as per UGC requirements. Can anybody tell that what are the AICT requirements of that in semester? How many time should be there? How many days should be there? Yes? Same. But how many working days means you are effective? Because All India Council, AICT, even UGC, they have specified the time that this should be minimum requirements for a particular program. Yes. Total is 90 days, out of which 15 days is for your examinations and preparation. Means your effective is 75 days. So your time requirements depends upon your level and duration of the program offering. Level kya hai aapka? Diploma, degree, and uska kitna time uski? What is the duration? Then number of abstract concepts to be taught. What is you are giving fundamental knowledge? Abstract concepts because our students are very poor in their basic fundamental concepts also. Types of skills to be developed. Because depending upon the program, diploma program or degree program, your skill set to be imparted to the students will be different. Because generally, but we say that for diploma program, there should be around 50-50%. 50% your theory and 50% should be the practicals. Roughly, it may change. And similarly, for degree program, it should be around 70% theory, 30% your practicals, or 80-20, depending upon the programs. But nowadays, more emphasis is on your skill sets, so that students are able to perform in the field. Then, bulk of content. Here, when we are deciding the time requirement, because we have limited time. We have 40 hours per week. That is what mostly following. As per AICT requirement, there is total 40 hours per week, out of which 6 to 8 hours are for student-centered activities, where the students will be going to the library for other NSS, NCC, your seminars, debates, sports activity, hobby clubs. So your effective time may be around 30 to 32 hours for imparting the instruction. So accordingly, we will have to decide the important contents. When we are doing activity analysis, there may be some repetition in the knowledge part, in the skill part. So depending upon the importance, there may be very repetition. So depending upon the time requirement, we will have to take important activities in our curriculum. Only sometimes we will have to delete, or we cannot incorporate some contents which do not have much weightage. We have to include those contents in our curriculum which are important, which have more weightage in terms of means. This is very essential for performing any activity in the industry.
These 40 hours are hours or number of periods?
These are hours. 40 hours per week. That is AICT says.
If I have a 5-day working,
then 8 hours per day.
Which excludes breaks in between.
That excludes, right.
College will be approximately 9 hours.
Like we have here in our institution, we have 9 to 5:30. So half hour is break. 1 to 1:30 is break. So we have a factor of 8 hours. That is what. Right? Or sometimes some institution may work for 6 days, so that your minimum requirement is fulfilled. Right? Then entry behavior of students. There may be some lateral entry of students also. So after allotting time to various subjects on the basis of factors listed above, the total time thus required to the course is checked against the constant of factor time available. You may have 5 or 6 subjects. Mostly what we include in our semester, minimum 5 to 6 subjects, not then more than that, because then you will not be able to justify the contents. So if you have 5 to 6 subjects, and then you have your lecture period and your practical period and your tutorial period, LTP. So accordingly, you will have to have limited time. Means you will be having 32 hours for your effective instructions. If you are taking 8 hours for your student-centered activities. But mostly what we do, we have 36 contact hours per week and 4 hours we give for student-centered activities. Sometimes 4, sometimes 3, and if time is available, then 5 also. But not more than 4 to 5 hours. So that we have more contact hours. Still, our teacher says that time is very less for delivering the contents because in developing the skill, we require more time. That is a repetitive type of activity. Then and only then, we develop skills in the students. Right? Then, horizontal and vertical organization. Here, what we do that we have number of subjects. In degree program, there may be 40 to 45 subjects. In diploma, 30 to 35 subjects. Now, we are to arrange the subjects in different semesters depending upon their logical sequencing. Means some subjects may be taught in the initial semester so that the students study the prerequisites first and then higher subjects later on. Like yesterday, I have given an example that if we are to teach a subject on structural mechanics, then the students must have studied subject of applied mechanics. Similarly, if we are to teach subjects on hydraulics engineering, the students must have some subject on hydraulics. That is different basic subjects, right? So like that, you cannot arrange the subjects haphazardly. There should be some logical sequence that we are going from concrete to abstract, simple to complex, and from known to unknown. That is very important. Some subjects can be taught simultaneously. It is educationally necessary to teach certain subjects in a chronological and logical manner because the knowledge of one is necessary for the understanding of the other. So you can think the subjects as per your branch, that which subject should be taught first and which subject should be taught later on. Because you have to organize all the subjects in degree program in 8 semesters. If you do not have any semester of training, then you have 8 semesters. Or if you have 1 semester of your internship, then you have 7 semesters. Similarly, in diploma program. So, logical and chronological arrangement of the various subjects of a curriculum is called horizontal and vertical organization of the curriculum.